Hello, Mr. Montalvo here, U.S. History. Today we're beginning Unit 5, Lesson 1, Day 1, The Rise of Fascism. So our objective for today is to examine how the worldwide economic depression and militant nationalism resulted in the rise of totalitarian rule. Now, in order to go deeper into this topic, it's important to understand what some of those terms that I've mentioned mean. So for our vocabulary for today, totalitarian is a type of government where no opposition is allowed. The government is in control of every aspect of life. Fascism, authoritarian or nationalistic form of government, usually run by a dictator. And then communism, we've discussed this term before, and we're going to expand upon it a bit today. Communism, economic and governing system where property is publicly owned and each person is paid according to their abilities and their need. So totalitarian leaders came into power in Italy and Germany. These dictators were fascists, drawing their allies among business leaders and landowners. And in 1922, Benedito Mussolini and his fascist party seized power in Italy. Mussolini outlawed all other political parties except his own and took control over the press. Critics were jailed or, in many cases, simply murdered. In schools, children recited the motto, Mussolini is always right. Now, in the 1930s, Mussolini used military aggression against the nation of Ethiopia. Now, the Ethiopian emperor, Haile Selassie, asked the League of Nations for help, but the League responded weakly, and Ethiopia fell to the invaders. Now, at this particular point in history, there are only two quote-unquote countries or nations within Africa whose sovereignty is recognized by the international community. And just a note on how sovereignty is recognized. Now, sovereignty meaning your independence as a nation. And in the international community, sovereignty is dictated by the fact of one nation having alliances with or treaties with other nations. That recognition by other nations and those treaties are that form of recognition as an independent and sovereign nation. And as such, when Ethiopia requested help from the League of Nations, they should have received it. Now, the harsh terms included in the treaties ending World War I have been used to explain the rise of Nazism in Germany, or the fascist dictatorship that would arise in Germany. Adolf Hitler brought the Nationalist Socialist German Workers' Party, or Nazi Party, to power. Hitler blamed the Versailles Treaty for the heavy war costs, and he claimed that Jews and other traitors had betrayed Germany. The argument was false, but Hitler was very eager to scapegoat or to find a person or a group of people to blame for the country's larger issues. When the German Depression hit, the people looked to Hitler for the answer to their problems. And in 1933, Hitler became the chancellor or the head of the German government. In Nazi Germany, the government controlled the press, schools, and religion. Once again, the major aspects of cultural life. Hitler claimed that Germany had the right to expand east. Anywhere that there were Germans, there was Germany, according to Hitler. And in 1936, German troops moved into the Rhineland. And if you can see on the map below, this is the area to the left of Germany, near the border of France and Belgium. This was in defiance of the Versailles Treaty. Now, why the Rhineland? Well, one, the Rhineland because it at one point belonged to Germany. But two, the iron mines and the heavy minerals that were available in the Rhineland that Germany wanted to take advantage of. This was being used to pay off portions of the money owed from Germany after World War I, and Hitler wanted that those resources for the German people. Now, France and Britain protested, but they did not take any action. Japan's economy suffered severely in the Great Depression. Military leaders took power over the country, and the Japanese preached racial superiority, believing they were pure and superior to all other Asians and non-Asians. After Lenin's death in 1924, Joseph Stalin gained power in the Soviet Union. Stalin ruled as a totalitarian dictator of a communist government, drawing power from particularly the working class. Stalin took very brutal measures to modernize the Soviet industry, and farmers were asked to turn over their farms. If the farmers resisted, they were most often executed. This idea of communizing land or the communal ownership of land, the land belonged to the people, not one particular person. Now, these key players and groups are going to become very important in the coming days and the coming throughout this lesson. Now, one in particular who, of course, we're going to mention quite a bit is Adolf Hitler. And so there is an article linked to the text, or rather to this presentation. And I'm asking you to identify the significance. So why is the event described, or in this case, the person described in the article taught in schools today? And then what are the lasting lessons that we can learn from studying this event? And then supporting your response, of course, with evidence from the text. In addition to that, there is an activity that will provide a deep historical context for World War I, or rather for World War II, and will enrich our further discussions. And that's also linked to this, this presentation as well. And just to close up, so try to explain how the worldwide economic depression and militant nationalism resulted in the rise of totalitarian rule. So just going back to our objective from today and seeing how what we've discussed applies to that and answers that question. It was great speaking with all of you today. I hope to see you again.